So what about discrete conformal mapping? Imagine we would like to map this nice duck, which was created by Ken Stevenson, to the unit disk. And the traditional way of doing it is that we take a penny pattern, cover the duck, and we cut everything which is outside, more or less. And then we use Köber Andrea Thurston to fill the unit disk. And this can be interpreted as a discrete conformal mapping because the disk and the packing are associated to one another. So what is a disadvantage of this cookie cutting? First of all, the approximation near the boundary is not very accurate. But what is more important is that the combinatorics determine the geometry determines the combinatorics. So if we have two such domains, say an ellipse and a square, then we have typically a different number, and in almost any case we have a different combinatorics. So if we map this ellipse to the disk, we get this structure, and if we map the square to the disk, we get that one. And what we would like to have is a disk and circle packing filling all three domains with the same contact graph. And this would allow also to interpret this as a discrete conformal mapping between ellipse and square, which is impossible using this cookie cutting approach. So, and our objective was to study finite circle packings with a given contact graph, which fill arbitrary bounded, simply connected domains, which need not to be Jordan. We are interested in these basic questions. What about existence? What about uniqueness? In general, we cannot expect uniqueness. We need some additional normalization. So what are appropriate conditions for normalization, and some further questions? So what about results, known results when we started this? There's a series of papers by Odette Schramm and Zheng Xu He from the 1990s, where they studied not only circle packings, but more general structures of packable sets. They obtained very stunning results about the existence, but they did not explore uniqueness to its full extent. And this has a good reason, which we will see during this talk. Moreover, it happens that in some cases, we cannot fill a domain by disks with positive radius, but some disks may degenerate to points, radius zero. And it was not studied seriously in the literature when and how this happens. And the last thing is that the approach of He and Schramm relies on Köber's uniformization theorem, even generalizations of it. And we wanted to get an elementary approach. And the idea was to use Sperner's lemma and induction. Okay, I'm sure that you all know what the circle packing is, but I still nevertheless say a few words about it. A circle packing is a pattern of disks, I will say. I will prefer to speak of disks in a packing for some reason. There's an ensemble of disks which have a prescribed pattern of tangencies, and these tangencies are encoded in a simplicial complex K, and we assume that this K is a topological disk. And the set of all these complexes K is called admissible. It turned out that we cannot work with admissible complexes only when we would like to realize our approach, because in the proof there appear complexes which are more general. Even when we start with admissible complexes, we necessarily have to enlarge this class. And this leads to a class which we call acceptable complexes. I will explain what it is later. Here you see just two different complexes. On the left-hand side, this is a conventional admissible complex and the corresponding circle packing. And in the middle, you see an admissible complex by the black lines, black edges, and a circle agglomeration. This is also a circle agglomeration. It is the simplest one, just consisting of one disk. So, and as a standing assumption, we have that all agglomerations consist of a finite number of non-overlapping disks. Just adjust something here. Okay. So what does it mean that the circle packing fills a Jordan domain? Let's start with this simple case. Very natural, we require that all disks are contained in this domain G in the usual sense, inclusion of sets, and all boundary disks touch the boundary of this G. Here you see the colored disks are the boundary disks, and this is also defined in the set theoretic sense. We have to change this later. On the right, this is not a conventional circle packing because its boundary disks have a more complicated structure. We find such triangles, for instance, here. But this is still an acceptable complex, so it's a circle agglomeration. Next thing we have to discuss, I have the impression that you cannot really see the headline, that this is somehow disturbed. Maybe. Yeah, I don't know what to do. Somehow this is this.
I see uniqueness and normalization.
Can you read it? This is.
It's a puzzle. It's easy
it's a
to
puzzle,
solve.
Yeah. Somehow there are two windows are overlaying each other. I don't know how to. Okay. Ah, I see. I think it's better now, yeah?
Yes.
Okay. So our next question is, what are appropriate normalizations? Let's start with the continuous case, conformal mapping. This is a standard normalization of conformal mapping. It's not the only one. There are several alternatives. And we will mainly use Karl Theodori's normalization, where we prescribe the images of three points on the boundary. This makes sense for Jordan domains. In the discrete case, we would get normalization conditions like this. We fix a center of an interior circle and the direction to a neighboring circle. The second case looks like this. We pick three points on the boundary of our domain, and we have three disks here, which we call the leading disks, and require that these three disks touch the points on the boundary. Now, this works well in the continuous case for Jordan domains. If the domain is not Jordan, these boundary points have to be replaced by prime ends. I will not speak about prime ends. I mean, I have prepared kind of detour, one slide for prime ends. You may ask me after the talk what it means. If you are not familiar with prime ends, then just think about the Jordan case. This makes a big difference, but it is not so important to understand the basic ideas. So what is the problem with Carl Theodori's three-point normalization in the discrete case? Of course, disks cannot touch certain boundary points. For instance, if we have such a corner of a square, there will not be a disk who can touch this corner point. So we have chosen another setting, namely we define a trilateral. This is, consists of a domain and three boundary arcs, which are into which the boundary is decomposed, here called alpha, beta, and gamma. And the vertices of our trilateral are these points of intersection of these closed arcs. So on the left, you see a Jordan case. In the middle, this is a domain with a slit. This is just a slit here. And then we have to be careful because the points on this slit can belong to a prime end which comes from the right, and it can also belong to a prime end which comes from the left. So these two sides of the slit are different, and it can even be more complicated. So what we see on the right hand side, this is a complicated or a visualization of a complicated prime end. It's not the prime end itself. This line here on the boundary, this is the impression of a prime end. So prime ends need not be points. And we say that the disk meets the prime end when it meets the two neighboring arcs which meet at this prime end. Okay, so far so much about the geometry. Now a little bit about combinatorics. We define a new object which is called a tricomplex. A tricomplex is an admissible complex which has exactly three boundary points, boundary vertices shown here. And the complex for the packing, this will be the interior of this tricomplex. When we start with a packing, with an admissible packing in the interior, we can frame it by adding three boundary vertices like this. This can be done in different ways, but this is our fundamental procedure. And the result is always a tricomplex. And this tricomplex has three distinguished boundary vertices and three distinguished interior vertices. They need not be different. They can coincide. These are the leading vertices of our tricomplex. And now this is the definition of acceptable complexes. All complexes K which can be converted to a tricomplex by framing are acceptable. Okay, what now we combine the two things. We have now a tricomplex, and we have first of all, or in the first approach, we have a Jordan trilateral. And we say what it means that a circle agglomeration P is associated with this tricomplex and fills this Jordan trilateral. Namely, very natural again, all disks must lie in G, and each boundary disk touches the corresponding arcs that are associated with those vertices which are neighbors of this V. So here we have our boundary vertices of T which are associated with the arcs, and then we have the other vertices in the interior, seven circles or seven disks are associated, and three leading vertices and leading disks must touch the corresponding prime ends here, or must meet this corresponding prime end. They need not touch, but they have to touch the both arcs which are to which this prime end belongs. Okay. So we will often call this leading this D1, D2, D3. This is just the notation. And this is a corresponding picture for a circle agglomeration. This Apollonian type packing is a circle agglomeration which fills this trilateral unit disk decomposed into these three arcs. So we start now with a baby version, which we use to sharpen our tools, namely with the simplest acceptable complex, which just has a single vertex. And this can be framed in just one way. And what it means that a circle agglomeration associated with this complex fills a trilateral means we have to find an in-circle which touches all three arcs of this trilateral. Here on the right-hand side, you see this nice image created by David Brieck. And we are looking for an in-circle. I'm always not sure if we can see the complete slide, but I hope so. The result is that every trilateral, no matter how the domain is, it must be, of course, simply connected and bounded, has an in-circle. Here it is. And I'd like to take this opportunity to demonstrate the basic idea of the proof, which we will generalize in the end. And this is based on the Sperner's lemma. So what is Sperner's lemma? We have a triangle. Now it's a proper triangle with vertices called denoted by RG and B. And we triangulate this triangle. This can be done in different ways, but I have just chosen such a uniform triangulation. This is not necessary. It can be an arbitrary triangulation. And now we color every vertex of T with one of these three colors, red, green, and blue. And of course, the vertex R has to be colored red, G green, D blue, as shown here. The vertices on these three sides have to be colored with one of the two colors at the end of these sides. And in the interior, the coloring is arbitrary. And then Sperner's lemma tells us that at least one of the triangles carries all colors at its vertices. When we refine this, we find again, in this case, three triangles. But what is interesting, this old triangle is not among the new ones. This has a nice combinatorial proof, and we would like to apply this to prove the existence of this in-circle. So what we do, we color the points in our domain, a point set, according to the closest arc. So for each point, we look which arc is the closest, and we color this point in the same way as this arc is colored, with some preference, say red beats green beats blue. And for this domain G, we get this coloring. And now we can use Sperner's lemma. So we have to refine this triangle and map it appropriately to the domain. And then we get such a point where all colors meet, which means it has the same distance to all three boundary arcs. So to prove this, we need Sperner's lemma and the compactness argument. Okay, this is existence. What about uniqueness? Of course, this in-circle need not be unique. If we have a triangle, a trilateral like this one, which has an inside corner here, then there are two such in-circles. The reason is that this trilateral is not tame. By tame, this is the definition here. We mean the following. We take a prime end and call it regular if for any two disks which touch this prime end, necessarily one of the disks is contained in the other one. And this is violated in this case. And a trilateral is tame if all its vertices are regular. So this is a tame trilateral, clearly all boundary points are regular. This is also a tame trilateral because this is not a vertex of our trilateral. We only have three vertices, one here, one there, and the third one down here. This is also tame. Remember that we now have a slit, and I have tried to visualize the two, the prime ends on one side with this dot, and the prime end on the other side with this one. This is not a vertex, so there's no violation of regularity. This is also a tame trilateral because these two disks here touch different prime ends. Geometrically in the plane, they touch the same point, but they touch different prime ends. But this is not tame because now these disks touch the same prime end, and it's even worse, this prime end. This has a property which we call spiky because there are two disjoint disks which touch this prime end. This is the worst case which we can get. But the domain need not be very difficult to be spiky. Jordan trilaterals may be spiky as well. So this is one thing we have to take into account, that the quality of the boundary is important. The second thing is that disks filling, the disk packing or circle packings or circle agglomerations filling an arbitrary domain may degenerate. We would like to have a really general result in the sense that all domains can be filled by our configurations of circles or disks. And this is a very simple example of a Jordan domain and very simple combinatorics which cannot be filled by a conventional socket packing. Because if you think a bit about this, you see that these two leading disks are uniquely determined. They have to position at the places where they are. There is no choice. And for the third leading disk down here, there is only this place remaining. And then it must be a point. We do not call it a point. We call it a dot. Because due to the presence of prime ends and all this machinery we have to develop, we must distinguish between points and dots. Okay. So we get degenerate packings. The next issue is a combinatorial problem, because we cannot work with admissible complexes alone, but with acceptable complexes. We have to admit complexes, tricomplexes like the one on the left. And if you fill this trilateral on the right, then you see there is a leading disk. This is only one leading disk here corresponding to the yellow vertex, and this is almost an incircle. And these two vertices are associated with the dots. We call complexes of this type boundary reducible because there are triangles containing boundary vertices which are not faces. This is another one. And these two vertices must be associated with dots. So what about dots? Why do we distinguish between points and dots? If we have a domain which is not Jordan, then this distinction is necessary, because if we consider this as a dot sitting on the slit, it cannot be decided on which side, on which prime end it sits. It can sit on the left or on the right. So all dots are attached to at least one and at most two disks. This can be proved. And this happens either directly, so the dot and the disk are neighbors, or it happens indirectly by a chain of neighboring dots. And we say that a dot touches the prime end and it is attached to a disk that touches this prime end at the point where the dot sits. So there are two different dots which can sit at this yellow point, one on the left side touching the green prime end and one on the right side touching the red prime end. This depends on the combinatorics. And there's another issue, and this is then the final one. Namely, when we have two disks associated with vertices U and V, and they are attached to each other by a chain of dots, then they produce something which we call a pseudo contact point. Okay. What happens? You have seen it perhaps. Here are three dots sitting in between. And these pseudo contact points have to be taken into account when we would like to fill domains which are not Jordan. For instance, this is a pair of disks which lies inside this domain. This also, but this is not admitted because we have a pseudo contact point. These two disks touch different prime ends at this dot. Okay. So after all this preparation, I wanted to show you first all the obstacles which we had to overcome. But now we can state our main result. First of all, let me explain the setting again. We have a non-collapsed generalized circle agglomeration. This means we have this general type of combinatorics, and non-collapsed means at least one object in this packing is a disk. Not all are dots. And we allow that the complex K of this agglomeration is admissible. So, and it is framed by a tricomplex. Then we say that this P is associated with T and fills this trilateral if the following three conditions are satisfied. This was our standing assumption. Then let me explained the third one. This was also mentioned before. If we have a boundary vertex, then the disk or the dot touches the corresponding arcs in the sense which was explained above, these arcs which are associated with vertices which are neighbors of our boundary vertices. So it's a natural setting, I think. And there is a third condition about these contact points, namely if this P is a contact point or a pseudo contact point of two disks in our packing, then these two disks must touch the same prime end at this point. Here, if you look on the left side, we have leading disks here. No, these are not the leading disks. The dark ones are the leading. The leading disks are the bright one here, and these are associated, the dark ones are associated with dots. I'm wrong again. The leading objects are dots sitting here on the left side and here on the right side, and these dark ones are disks. So we can even have leading dots. Okay, and this is now our main result, namely, no matter how the tri-complex is structured and no matter how this trilateral is built, we always have a generalized circle agglomeration, which is associated with this tri-complex and with this domain G. This is existence. What about uniqueness? Uniqueness is guaranteed if this trilateral is tame. This is a natural result, I would say. And what about non-degenerateness? When are the circles or disks are proper objects and not degenerate, there's a condition. Two conditions. One is on the complex, it cannot be boundary irreducible, and the trilateral is not allowed to be spiky. We have seen examples showing that this is really necessary also. It's not necessary, it's essential. It's of course not necessary, but essential for uniqueness and non-degenerateness, regularities. So if we reduce the class of complexes to admissible complexes, so we are now speaking about conventional circle packings, then we get again a positive result if we assume that this T is boundary, because then this T is automatically boundary is irreducible. So what remains is this condition on the domain, it cannot be spiky. If we have a spiky trilateral, then we can have degenerate circle packings too, as we have seen. So, okay, I see I'm running out of time. So, okay, what are the ingredients of the proof? As announced, we want to use induction just by the number of vertices in the complex. Because this Sperner lemma proved useful for the existence of an in-circle, we wanted to extend it to this general situation. And we have to take care that we first work with smooth domains, and in a final step, we do an exhaustion of arbitrary domains by smooth domains, and we have to guarantee that in this approximation procedure, the disks do not degenerate in some cases. So this first step is based on combinatorial and geometrical surgery, which I will show in a minute. And this is the place where non-Jordan domains appear. We cannot stay in the class of Jordan domains. And where also acceptable complexes appear, we cannot stay in the class of admissible complex with traditional circle packings. This won't work, this approach. So, and the second application of Sperner's lemma needs uniqueness and continuous dependence on some parameters. So we have to do everything first for smooth domains and boundary irreducible complexes, and then generalize it to all domains or trilaterals. And in the third step, it may happen that this degenerate to dots. And this requires a very detailed investigation when this happens and when it cannot happen. Okay, so this is what we have to do. I will concentrate myself on the first and on the second part ingredient, and will not waste time to show you all the details. Many of these lemmas we had to prove seem to be obvious somehow, but if you think a bit careful about this, then they are not obvious. They need the proof. So what is about this surgery? The idea is we would like to remove one disk, and we take a leading disk, D1, which touches two of our arcs here, the red one and the green one. This should be eliminated, and consequently, we also eliminate this part of the domain which is behind Z. Of course, this requires that we also adapt the complex on the left-hand side. So, but first, we work with the geometry. We modify the arcs. We extend this blue arc, and we reduce the green arc. And we add a red arc, which is now formed by part of the boundary of this disk. I think these slides will be available after the talk at some time, and then you can click through it and see what is going on. I will speed up a little. So we must modify the complex. We would like to remove this disk. This means we must remove this here. And this arc, alpha prime, plays the role which played this disk D1 before. So we somehow have to merge this with this, the two red vertices. This is done here. So we get a new boundary disk here, boundary vertex, the blue one, and we have to change the combinatorics on the left. We also get new leading disks. So this D1 is changed to this. This remains, and this D1 is moved in some sense, or is substituted by this D1 prime. But the difficult thing is to prove that this always works. What we see is this new trilateral is not smooth. It has, it has kind of corners. And in most cases, when the disk D1 touches only one boundary point, then it's not even a Jordan domain. So removing a disk is, of course, simpler than the other way around. We also need a way to add a disk. What do we do? We have this trilateral, and imagine we have our packing somehow, or our combinatorics in behind. We start with a point set in the interior. We take the maximal disk which fits in this domain. This defines two prime ends, one here and one there. And we build the arcs of our trilateral accordingly, like before. Then we have leading disks in this new packing. Yeah, that's it. Of course, there are different situations. This is another one which we see here. Except in some degenerate cases, which are shown here, this construction always works, and it can be shown that it works. And now comes the main part, namely this Spurner coloring. We color the interior points of our domain. And we do it in the following way. So pick this point set from the beginning. In the first case, it is this one, here it is this one, here it is this one. Then we fill the trilateral, which we just have seen, by this modified packing. And we observe which arcs are touched by the leading disk of the corresponding original packing. Yeah, I think one must digest this for some time to understand what is going on. And then there are three situations which may happen, and they are described here. D1 touches the union of alpha and beta. This means touches. D1 touches alpha. Then we color the point red. This is shown on the left. In the second case, we color the point green. And in the third case, we color the point blue. So this is also a case of the green coloring. If you look at this carefully, then there is one logical case missing. This is this one here, shown on the right-hand side. This is impossible because the disks, roughly speaking, the disks have the wrong orientation. So this need not be. And the result is that we get a coloring of the interior of this G, except this line E, the exceptional line. And now one can prove the following implications. So in the first case, we have D1 touches alpha. This is per definition. But it cannot happen that D3 touches beta. This has to be proved. And also in the other cases, we get some additional implications, which means if you look at this now, if we have a point which belongs to all three colors or sets, this is a solution of our problem. And in fact, we get a Sperner coloring. And Sperner's lemma says the intersection is not empty. What we have to do before is that we have to color these exceptionals at E blue, and it has to be proved that this is compatible with the other things. Okay, this is basically the idea of the proof. Let me very briefly sketch what we do with regularity. We have now a trilateral which is not spiky by assumption, and this T is boundary irreducible, and then we get the assumption of a dot, existence of a dot, leads to the conclusion that we have two different disks which touch a point at S, which is associated with a leading vertex, and this is a contradiction to this not spikiness. Uniqueness is based on another result which we proved before in a paper on incompressibility of circle packings, where we do not fill trilaterals but quadrilaterals, and this could be generalized to the situation at hand. It relies heavily on a concept which was already introduced by Oded Schramm, the concept of loners. I cannot explain what it is here, but you may ask me, of course. What was new that we had to cope with these prime ends and dots? This makes things a bit more complicated. And finally, we need continuity results. This was maybe the most demanding thing. Our packings depend on certain parameters, for instance, on this point inside the domain, which we fixed in the beginning. And depending on this parameter, a lot of things is changing. The trilateral is changing, the packing is changing. And it was absolutely not obvious that we get this continuity. Okay. So in summary, we have a very nice result, but we don't have existence and uniqueness at the same time. Both need additional assumptions. Maybe the reason is that our setting was wrong. So why have we chosen this setting? Because it is the simplest for our approach, because we can remove leading this sitting at the boundary, and then we get something reasonable which can be treated by induction. In some sense, this seems to be the most natural generalization for domain filling circle packings or circle agglomerations, because it is close to the continuous case. And we thought, well, probably if we do it with in this setting, we get better results concerning existence of non-degenerate packings and uniqueness. So, did I show it to you? I think I have to go back. Yeah, and we were absolutely surprised that this skipped something. Yeah, probably I skipped the slide. So let me return to this. We expected this is the best setting. And it turned out that this was completely wrong. And let me explain first a heuristic reason why it went wrong. In the continuous case, these two side conditions are imposed at the same point. The second condition eliminates rotations. In the discrete case, they are imposed at different points, at the centers of two circles, which may be neighboring, but at sitting at different points. And if we compare this with the continuous situation, then this is similar to the requirement that the map maps a point on a contour line of our mapping function to the positive real axis. If this R is small, then we have a contour line which is round. But if this R is large, so that we are close to the boundary, this need not be so. And this is a heuristic reason why this second normalization fails. Now we wanted to have a concrete counterexample. And there are some obstacles. In some sense, we need on one side circles which are large, and on the other side circles which are small. And here is a counterexample. Such counterexamples must have domains which are highly non-convex. And it is constructed as the union of the carrier of two packings. This is one packing. This is the second packing. If we take and or make an overlay of both packings, you see the centers here. One is sitting exactly at the same point, and the other one is shifted a little bit in the horizontal direction. And the point is now that we can unify these two packings, round the corners a little bit, which does not disturb anything, to get a smooth domain. And if we now look at the boundary, then it is composed from arcs alternating between the two packings. So we always have a red arc followed by a blue arc, and a red arc followed by a blue arc, and so on. Okay, we could now work around everything. Of course, we verified that these results are reliable. Here are some arguments. We have no strict proof, I must say, but this is so, are these verification results also convincing? Then I think we need not a strict proof. Now I see, I would like to skip this. Yeah, we could walk around, and this is now really my final topic. So let me summarize this with this, the standard normalization, even for smooth domains and best complexes, we have no uniqueness. This was unexpected. Yeah, but maybe there's another setting, and it is. And I'm convinced that the best approach to these normalization conditions is to avoid contact points and to use avoid circle centers, but to use contact points alone. And this packing could be normalized by the contact points of two neighboring interior disks and the direction of their common center. And this is the conjecture I would like to pose here. Namely, if we have an admissible complex, this is the simpler version. For acceptable complexes, this setting is not well posed. But if we have an admissible complex, so a complex used in conventional circle packing, and we have two neighboring vertices, they should be interior vertices, and any bounded simply connected domain without loss of generality, we assume the origins, it's in this domain, then there exists exactly one non-degenerate circle packing, which is associated with this complex and fills our domain. And it is my hope that someone of you will prove this conjecture. We tried to prove it for some time, but well, we had no real good idea. Existence can be proved, but the hard part is really, and that this is this packing is non-degenerate can also be proved, but the hard part is to prove uniqueness. And this loner approach does not work when this normalization is inside. Okay, that's it. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. That was a really nice talk. Are there any questions?
I guess my sequence of slides was sometimes a bit fast, but I think there's a lot of text on it and explanations. So if one can go through all these details. I have a last slide with some references, of course. So I must say, David Krieg has done a lot of things here in his PhD thesis, and he has done much more than I described in this talk. And he was very tough in going through all these cases concerning about the combinatorics and
Yeah, I wanted to comment on that because the stuff you did on extrema length and filling rectangles is very interesting as well. And it highlights something that people may not notice, and that is that the adjustments of circle packings, making small changes, like changing the domain that you're packing, and watching the effects of those changes is often just fascinating. And the rigidity comes in neat ways. That loner argument you talked about that started with Schramm and that you guys exploited really shows the delicacy of the rigidity. And these modifications of some configuration and watching the effects of the modifications sort of takes you to a second level about understanding the packings. You got some very nice results there.
In this connection, I tried to show you some effect. Yeah, okay, that's it. concerning this continuous dependence on parameters, this was really surprising for us. As I said, we start with some point inside, take the maximal disk, and then we construct a new trilateral beginning at this vertex here and extending the green arc as long as possible until it touches this, and the blue arc here. But this is not continuous at all, this construction. If we cross, for instance, this line here, on the right-hand side, this maximal disk touches the green arc. So this green arc is very short. And on the left-hand side, it touches the blue arc. So the green arc extends from here over there. There's no continuity at all, but still the packing, filling these strange domains depends continuously on this point. Maybe I'm not wrong, at least the color depends. Also not the color. maybe this was not completely right, what I was saying. So we can manage this coloring. Here. Such that it is consistent and remains a Spurner coloring. Near this exceptional set E, there can never appear a red point. This is essential. There are green points and blue points on the left and green points on the right. And we can, by definition, say that all these points on E belong to the left side. But there are still cases where continuity is very surprising. Maybe my example was not the best one. but here, for instance, this is a better example. If we move this a bit on top, then the blue extends behind. And if we move it down, then the green extends behind. This is the case. Now the packing, filling this trilateral is still continuous, depends continuously on this point. The exception is that it's something different.
Can I ask?
Thank you.
Thank you for the very nice talk, Elias.
Thank you.
It reminds me of many things in Schramm's papers.
Yes, sure.
And yet what you've done is different. I wondered how much of what you have done depends on the fact that the objects you're packing are discs. Could you do it more generally with, say, smooth convex bodies homothetic to given ones?
Yeah, this is a good question. In fact, we do not use too much about these discs. I think it can also generalize to kind of objects considered by Schramm, but I mean, he has a definition of packable sets, which is related to homothetic transformations of these objects. This, of course, is also needed in this case, but moreover, we need some assumption relating the shape of the objects in the packing and the shape of the domain. And this is not so clear to me. I mean, we were happy when we managed to prove these results. And well, this was not always funny, I must say. there are only a few cases where I was suffering from mathematics, and this was one. I mean, maybe it was the worst case.
Right. I suppose at least the definition of a tame trilateral or a tame boundary point depends very much on the fact that it's discs that you're packing.
Yeah. And with this spikiness, this is even worse. I mean, there you have two discs which touch the same point. And if you have general objects, I don't know which shapes are admitted then. No, but there's still a lot of work to do. I think I will not do anything with these. Oh, let me. Oh, no. I did my job with these circle packings, and I think I will not work seriously on proving this conjecture, first of all, because new ideas are needed, and also new energy is needed. And but to me, this is really the fundamental question about discrete conformal mapping, because this would really be a discrete counterpart of the Riemann mapping theorem. For any complex, we get a unique domain or trilateral domain filling, say, domain filling, circle packing, non-degenerate, which fills this domain under this normalization.
If you take that configuration, if you take that configuration and you do an inversion about the contact point, then it becomes a problem packing into a strip, but you have the inverse of the domain boundary to worry about.
We tried, but without success so far. I mean, maybe during this workshop we get some ideas, but our attempts failed so far. We had this idea, of course, to do an inversion.
Your counterexample for the other normalization is very neat.
Yeah, if I still have time, I can say a few words about this, how it was constructed. Okay. Oh, maybe this is the best.
It seems like getting the arcs to alternate must have been difficult. Yeah.
It is difficult. It is difficult. We really would like to have a simple, transparent counterexample where the packing forms a nice shape and maybe symmetric also. And to get also a strict mathematical proof, so to say. But we did not succeed. The point is that we need circles which are of different size, and we need this non-convexity. And this was constructed by an heuristic algorithm starting with this alpha circle here, which is fixed. And then there is a first layer around here, which does not completely close. So this is fitted to make it close. And then there is a second layer. And you see the degree is relatively high. So this disk from the first layer, I can zoom in probably. Yeah. So here, this is the last disk from the first layer. This is the first disk, and then we start out here. So, and here we construct again disks touching this one and this one. These are chains, and they are, their radii are growing according to some heuristic law. And this goes on and on until we have closed the second. And then there comes part of a third layer. And this was automated somehow involving parameters which could be adjusted. And in the end, fortunately, we got this counterexample, which I really consider to be safe because you see, we checked everything. First of all, this is not a packing which fills something. These are two independent packings which are just overlaid. So we need not to check such filling conditions. So what we checked is the contact conditions that these circles or disks fit nicely, these which must fit, which must be tangents. The side conditions are satisfied exactly because we overlay base both packings. And we checked what we call critical distances of contact. This is something which can be explained here. We need a red arc and a blue arc. And the presence of this blue arc depends on the position of this red contact point here. So this must be outside. It must be inside the blue disk. So here it is very safe. This is far away. But sometimes this red point is close to the boundary, and this is checked, and it's about 1%. So considering this accuracy, this is safe. And also we checked all these intersection angles. Of course, I mean, if two disks are almost tangent, then a very small perturbation can change this absolutely. But these intersection angles are also at a reasonable size of more than 3 degrees.